Hello, this is DJ Anish. I bet all along you thought I was a human, but guess what? I am dog. Yes, it is I that have been doing all the podcasts this entire time. You've been taught by a dog. In fact, would you like to see what your human teacher is up to?
Hey. Go.
I know, it's pathetic, isn't it? Welcome to today's podcast brought to you by Dog.
Okay guys, welcome to another episode of DJ Anish Podcast, the only podcast that gives you your SEA fix. The podcast that no one has ever asked for, but here we are. And I know week in, week out, you guys enjoy this, listening to the sound of my soothing voice. I took some feedback from the batch, especially from Xavier. Xavier, if you are listening, shout out to you. Saying that the intro part is always the most interesting and after that it just goes downhill from there. Number one, I did warn you about that. Warn you guys about that, and well, it's a free podcast, so you know, don't expect too much. In the future, maybe you get sponsorship deals and stuff, the content can be better. But number two, I take into account what you said, and throughout the entire podcast, we'll have some commercials and some contests as well. The last time round, the contest, we had some winners, and they were Shen Ling, Angela, and Kai Jin. But this time round, I think I'll make it a bit more difficult. So listen out for the instructions, follow the clues, and I hope you guys win it, whatever the prize is. So today we are going to be talking about the Vietnamese invasion of Cambodia in 1978, lasting all the way till 1991. The first part of today's podcast, I've already gone through with you guys during tutorial, so I will kind of like try to speed through that a bit, but I thought it would be good in case you guys need a refresher or you missed out some stuff and you want to hear it again, so I thought that that would be a good thing to do. The second thing would be to go into ASEAN's management of the Vietnamese invasion of Cambodia, this entirety of the conflict. So that would be more of the focus of the podcast for today. But take note that with regards to the SPQ testing, a whole SPQ, six sources, hypothesis, everything can be about just about the invasion of Vietnam on Cambodia itself, meaning to say that there is no ASEAN involvement in the reading of those sources or in the doing of that SPQ. But conversely, there could be another SPQ where there is ASEAN involvement and the hypothesis would revolve more around the effectiveness of ASEAN's management of the conflict. So before I go into the content today, and especially on ASEAN, once again, remember and focus on the language that I use, ASEAN's management. Management is the key here. Of the Cambodian invasion, of the Vietnamese invasion of Cambodia. Remember that when we judge ASEAN, we have to judge it by its mandate, by its objectives, by its approaches, and then we can give a fairer assessment of whether ASEAN is effective or not. So, going into the invasion itself, the maps, stare at it for a while, and make sure that you know the geopolitics of Indochina and especially mainland Southeast Asia, even where China itself is located as well, it would come into play as we understand the genesis and the development of this conflict. So stare at this map, and I hope that you stare at this map. Stare at this map now. Make it imprinted in your mind. Stare already not. Stare. Okay, good. Let's move on. Now, another guy whom I don't think we all need to stare at, Pol Pot. We've been through Cambodian leader, communist, mass genocide, so on and so forth. I think we've been through all these things really. So The Vietnamese invasion of Cambodia, it will be called by other names as well. It might be called the Third Indochina War. It might be called the Cambodian conflict. But whatever it is, it will all refer to the same thing. The old name for Cambodia is Kampuchea. So if you see that, it also just refers to Cambodia itself. What started out as a local conflict between two Southeast Asian nations quickly escalated and dragged in great powers and superpowers. And thus, that might account a bit for why the conflict period lasted for so long, why it was so difficult to resolve. But for today's focus, we also want to understand, given this context, how ASEAN enters the management process, and what kind of challenges and opportunities did ASEAN face, and ultimately, were they effective in trying to mediate and manage this conflict? Because it does concern regional peace and security. I think one thing to highlight is that at this point in time, Vietnam and Cambodia, they are not ASEAN members at this stage yet. They will become ASEAN members later on, but at this point in time, they are not ASEAN members. But remember that one of the objectives set by ASEAN, what the mandate that ASEAN has, is to try as best to foster cooperation to ensure regional peace and stability. So the word regional here plays a bit because this conflict is within the Southeast Asian region, and because ASEAN is that representative body that, you know, manages regional affairs, this would come into play as well, which is why even though ASEAN members are not direct disputants, the organization itself would have some interest to manage this conflict towards a peaceful resolution. The first time the war is fought by communists on all sides, Vietnam, Cambodia, and later on even China. So truly an unprecedented war. Another map for you to stare. I hope you've stared long enough to get an imprint of what the geopolitics of Indochina and China as well looks like. So I'm going to speed through this because we've been through this in tutorials already. But basically, long story short, the TLDR version is that at one point in time when Cambodia and Vietnam, the communists, when they had a common enemy in the form of America, they were strategic allies. Now, when I use the word strategic allies, it implies that this was more of a marriage of convenience, but there was still a lot of underlying mistrust, a lot of underlying tension between the two nations and their troops. And this might go into history, this might go into ethnicity as to account to why there's a bad blood between these two ethnic groups and why there's so much historical tension underlying that. So when the Americans exit from Southeast Asia and Vietnam, all the underlying tensions start to resurface again. At first, it starts out with small-scale level kind of stuff, and these kind of things can be controlled. They won't amount to a diplomatic crisis between the two nations. It's more like irritants in the relationship rather than anything else. But as time wears on, you can see that the actions and the reactions get a lot larger, and it also gets a lot more physical, it gets a lot more violent, it's a lot more belligerent. When you consider the development and the escalation of the crisis leading to the invasion itself, remember the important thing to consider here is the criteria. When you judge responsibility, when you track the development of a crisis, it's good to keep the criteria at the forefront of your mind. Who was the one who actively provoked it? Who was the one who engaged in military action? Who was the one who was uncooperative? And so on and so forth. You have to judge. You have to come up with a list of criteria. But one thing that I want you all to note is that as you do this more and more, and right now our focus here is on responsibility, like who is responsible for, you know, causing the conflict and all that. As you do more and more of these question types, like this is a question type on responsibility, you realize, right, that actually the criteria is more or less the same for every type of conflict. You are using the same criteria lens to look at confrontasi, to look at Sabah, to look at the Vietnam War, to look at this Cambodian invasion. It's the same thing. Like, more or less, it's going to be the same set of criteria, which is why I say the more you do, the more it becomes ingrained because you are practicing it more and more. So it's good to identify the question types, have a set list of criteria that you can use to judge. Of course, it might evolve across different conflicts, but it wouldn't be all that much different. So I think practice is the key, and be aware that you need to think about criteria that is related to the question type. So with regards to this, it continues to escalate, and now you have the involvement of a large number of physical troops, the military is involved, and so on and so forth. Finally, mediation has failed. The Vietnamese authorities, the VCP, the Communist Party, they decide that diplomacy is no longer a viable option, and they launched their invasion 25th December 1978. So this is a whole series of events that leads to the invasion itself. We can see that responsibility lies on both sides. But what is the true nature of why Vietnam invaded? I think that's something for you guys to assess, investigate, debate as well. The continued escalation of this conflict can be seen through the lens of the entry of external powers as well. Again, drank too much coffee. And Yati, if you're listening to this, I hope that you're not listening to it in the library once again and get a shock of your life. And I apologize to all of you who heard that. This is not one of the commercial breaks, but an unforced interruption. Anyway, one of the things that we want to consider, and as with all, you know, conflicts that exist in this time period, is, you know, did they start out as civil conflicts, or did they start out as a bilateral conflict but then got escalated way beyond its original aims and intent to become something caught up with Cold War politics? So that's something that it seems to be a trend during the Cold War period. And I think that we have seen in tutorials, this was the same for this conflict between Vietnam and Cambodia itself, that it did get caught up in a lot of lines in Cold War politics, which, once again, even though by this point in time, it is about 30 years after the beginning of the Cold War, you can see that it is still very much alive. We can see that geopolitics continues to hold the forefront of the minds of the great powers and the superpowers. And we can see that concepts like the zero-sum game, bipolarity, they all still have huge relevance, and they still dictate foreign policy at this point in time. So Cambodia and Vietnam, they get caught up in this. The first one you can see over here is China. I did mention that China and Vietnam, historically speaking, they don't have the best of relationships. China has tried to invade Vietnam on a number of occasions across their history. And once again, we have to dig up the past, historical bad blood, and so on and so forth. I think that would play into the decision of China to invade Vietnam at this point in time. Of course, they are trying to capitalize on the chaos that is going on. They are trying to the limits of my Chinese can offer you. But it was a calculated move in order to try to weaken Vietnam. So that was China's policy against this whole thing. So they demanded for the unconditional surrender. And crucially here, they threw their support behind Cambodia. So the Chinese are throwing their support behind Cambodia against Vietnam. And this is part one of the story with regards to external interference. They invaded Vietnam from February to March 1979. And again, we've been through this in tutorials, but in March 1979, they declared that the gates to Hanoi was open. And after that, they withdrew their forces. At that point in time, I think no one knew really what the situation was about. But later on, as we dig up sources, we could see that the Chinese troops weren't doing that well. And in their own cost-benefit analysis, I think they decided to withdraw because they had fulfilled some limited objectives, and I think it was good enough for them at that point in time. But part two of the story comes in when you have the involvement of the Soviets. Remember that the context of Cold War politics at this point in time is that there's a Sino-Soviet split. Somewhere around in the mid-1960s, it was revealed to the world that the communist bloc was not a monolith, meaning to say that not all communist nations thought the same, not all communist nations were in line, not all communist nations were friends and allies and all that kind of stuff. And the biggest schism that we see was between China and Russia. And this continued on even now, 20 years later, where China and Russia are continuing to compete for the leadership of the communist world. So Russia and China also have their own zero-sum game framework when it comes to their foreign policy, when it comes to spheres of influence. So that's now part one. China threw their support behind Cambodia, and now the Soviets, in a bid to continue this Sino-Soviet rivalry, throws their support behind Vietnam. And this kind of like starts to get you to think as to why the war continued to drag on, especially when it comes to the intervention of great and superpowers. Their agenda would usually dominate, and you know that great powers and superpowers very seldom would they budge on issues concerning their national interests, and so it becomes very hard to move the resolution process, and that could be a context for you to keep in mind as we understand how ASEAN tries to deal with this issue later on. And the last superpower, the biggest of all, the one that we have to talk about as well, is the USA. And you would think that the USA, because of the whole Vietnam War experience, they would wash their hands off this region. I mean, the Vietnam War was a huge humiliation to US prestige. Militarily speaking, I don't think the US really lost the war in that sense, but I think it was a huge damage to their political prestige and their political credibility, and you would think that they wouldn't want any involvement in this part of the world after that. Well, that's true to a certain angle, because I think the US would never ever commit ground troops, their American GIs, they would never commit them to an active war in this region again, especially not with Vietnam. But that doesn't mean that they can't throw political support, that doesn't mean they can't throw diplomatic support, that doesn't mean that they can't throw financial support. And that's what they did over here, because they wanted to deepen the divide between China and the Soviet Union. They wanted to play their enemies against one another. So, as one of you rightly pointed out, 孙子兵法, the enemy of my enemy is my friend. 我的敌人的敌人就是我的朋友. I'm pretty sure that was just a literal translation and not actually what Sun Tzu said, but you get the idea. And so, China, US threw their support behind China. And at this point in time, US-China relations, they also have their own kind of history and trajectory. By this point in time, the US and China already have some sort of a stable relationship going. And I think this is just the latest in a series of episodes concerning US-China relations. Keep in mind at this point in time that the US, their main adversary, their main rival, will still be the Soviet Union. I don't think that has ever changed during the entirety of the Cold War period. I think in the concept of bipolarity, this kind of enemy or adversary wouldn't change in that sense. Primarily because these are two superpowers. China is not a superpower. China is a great power. And in the world of bipolarity, only the superpowers matter. And so with this kind of framework in mind, the US is looking out for opportunities in order to meet the other superpower in terms of competition. So we have the involvement of the great powers. And one of the things that I want you to also take note of is the speed and the intensity, and maybe also the degree of commitment that the great powers intervened in this conflict. It was really fast, actually. It was within a span of months and within a year, all these powers are involved in this conflict. So we can see that the Cold War was very much alive, and I guess a lot of the initial aims and intents of Vietnam and Cambodia were hijacked by superpower interests. And this is going to be a running theme in this conflict as we look at ASEAN's management later on. So we can see the world is kind of looks like this, you know, divided by polarity and all that kind of stuff. And it's still very much alive. Right now, the theater of war that we're looking at is in Vietnam and Cambodia. So the first part is what we've been through, tutorials, and I'll end it off with here, which is that when we assess the conflict itself, the genesis of the conflict, like why did the conflict happen and all that, there are four broad categories of motivations and causes which lead to this conflict. And some are more long-term, some are more immediate, some are more on the Vietnamese side, some are more on the Cambodian side, and so on. So it's up to you to look at it and to look at the sources when you receive them, and then make your own assessments and evaluation based on what you see in the sources. But I thought it was a good idea to give you a huge spread of all the concurrent elements involved in this conflict, so you can get a sense of the complexity, and you can see how to any conflict there are a multitude of factors, and our idea is to balance the perspectives and to deliver our assessment and our argument. So it's worthwhile looking at all these things and then trying to match them to the content, and then also finding your voice in all of this. Now, finally we come to today's focus, this podcast, the focus. We are looking at how ASEAN manages this conflict. So the hypothesis here would shift a bit, and we'll be looking at the organization, and specifically I think our focus would be on looking at the effectiveness of ASEAN. So how did ASEAN manage this conflict, and to what degree was it effective? What's the approach that ASEAN took? What is its relationship with external powers and external bodies as well? I think that's a really crucial element to understand ASEAN's management of conflicts, its relationship with external powers and with external bodies. So what might look like a weakness might actually have been a strength, in the sense that this was their diplomatic strategy. So let's explore that a bit further later on as we go into the content. Now, I've broken down ASEAN responses into a timeline. It's a very long period of occupation, spanning about 10 years or so. So I break it down into certain categories based on chronology. So let's take a look at the initial responses first. Of course, ASEAN's main weapon, its main tool, is always going to be diplomacy. ASEAN is not by character military or belligerent organization. So its first mode of action is always going to be opening diplomatic channels. That's always going to be the first mode of action here. So we can see that in January, which this is what, 12-13 January, so it's just literally it's about 2 weeks after the initial invasion itself, immediately documents and pronunciations emerge from the organization, and they call for the immediate and total withdrawal of foreign forces from Kampuchean territory. Later on, with regards to the Chinese invasion, same thing, calling for the withdrawal of all foreign forces from both Vietnam and Cambodia. Now, when you read these documents, I want you to try to connect them to ASEAN Way principles. Remember, we are trying to understand how ASEAN works and what kind of approaches and principles do they abide by in order to use them as a mechanism to deal with interstate conflict. Just by these bolded quotations itself, right, you can see that the ASEAN Way principle of the respect for state sovereignty. It's clearly over there. And also the idea of non-use of force. And also the idea of non-interference. Now, these three big principles of the ASEAN Way approaches are seen just by looking at these two quotations itself. Number one, again, the respect of state sovereignty and international law. Number two, the value of non-interference. And number three, non-use of force. So all these things are what ASEAN clearly communicates as its first mode of action when the invasion happens. So a diplomatic response in this case. Now, the second point that I want to talk about in terms of their initial response, you can see the first point over there. They deny the puppet government international recognition and aid. Now, what this means is this. When Vietnam invaded Cambodia, Vietnam actually didn't rule Cambodia like directly in that sense. What Vietnam did, remember their objective was to remove the Khmer Rouge regime, remove Pol Pot and the Khmer Rouge regime. So that they did. And what Vietnam did was that actually Vietnam installed a Cambodian government, but it's a puppet government to Vietnam. So this puppet government, this Cambodian puppet government, was called the People's Republic of Kampuchea, PRK. So this PRK is like a proxy government. It's Cambodian, but it is under a shroud of Vietnamese rule. So everyone can see that, lah. I mean, it's not a you don't need to be rocket scientist to figure that out. And so ASEAN lobbies for this PRK not to be recognized because they can see that this is interfering in domestic politics. This is Vietnam interfering in Cambodian domestic politics. So, once again, the principle of non-interference would apply. Not only that, ASEAN also mounted and lobbied for political and economic pressure. And take a look at number three, diplomatic action through the UN and the non-aligned movement. So, one of the earlier goals I wanted you guys to take note of is the relationship between ASEAN and external bodies. So take a look at this, where they reach out to UN and NAM platforms in order to get their message across consistently by an international community. Now, in this case, some would argue and say that, oh, because ASEAN in itself is inherently weak, therefore they need larger, more credible bodies, bodies with more political clout in order to increase the ante and to increase the pressure. Okay, yeah, I can agree with that as well. But at the same time, going into ASEAN's mandate, going into ASEAN's strategy and approaches, was this always part of their diplomatic strategy? The calculation to use international bodies like themselves and to mount a concerted effort against such an interstate conflict. So I leave it up to you. Again, this is not ASEAN propaganda or whatever, although some of you might think so, but I leave it up to you guys in order to think it through. But there are two sides to the story, and I think more research on your part would reveal what your inclinations might be. So the fourth point here, they blocked the move by Vietnam to get the PRK recognized. It's the same thing as point number one. And in order, ASEAN made this claim, and this one is going to be a bit important for something I'm going to talk about later. But ASEAN made this stand that in order for negotiations to take place, in order for diplomacy to resume with Vietnam especially, the condition, the precondition was that Vietnamese needed to withdraw all of its military forces from Cambodia. Again, look at how ASEAN stands by and abides by the ASEAN Way principles. Respect of state sovereignty, non-use of force, non-interference, all these things play out. They are mounting their stand, they are clearly communicating it, not just to Vietnam, but to the entire world as well. Now, with regards to the initial responses, they are diplomatic by nature and it's initial, you know, it's early days and all that kind of stuff. But are there certain successes that we can credit? Now, of course, there is no resolution at this stage. But to criticize ASEAN and say that, oh, you know, no matter what they did, there was no resolution at this point in time, I think that is a bit too harsh. And I don't think that that respects the context of the situation as well. So let's try to find certain successes that we can credit to ASEAN, even in this initial period. Now, remember I told you that they worked through UN platforms, and you can see in point one over here, they successfully lobbied for a resolution calling for a ceasefire, withdrawal of forces, and the convening of an international conference on the conflict. They won it by 91 to 21 vote. So you can see that even with ASEAN lobbying at an international platform, there is some momentum there, there is some traction. ASEAN does have some clout by this stage in the international platforms. So when you think about the relationship between UN and ASEAN, I honestly don't think that they ever saw themselves as competitive against one another. They are not two competing international organizations. ASEAN needs the UN for some purposes. The UN needs ASEAN for some purposes as well. So I see it more as a collaborative relationship, one that is workable, one that it's mutually beneficial as well. But at this stage, I think it's also important to recognize the limitations that ASEAN has, and specifically with regards to its member states. Once again, it is not the case that ASEAN is, the five ASEAN members are in unison with one another. I mean, they may make all these consensus statements going forward, you know, regarding to Vietnam, but beneath that, there are still a lot of strategic divergences. There are still a lot of national-based thinking when it concerns the five members of ASEAN at this point in time. So what do they disagree upon? Number one, some nations want to be more aggressive towards Vietnam and some want to take the more moderate approach. When I mean aggressive and moderate, I'm still thinking in terms of diplomatic means, not like, you know, go to war with them and stuff. It's more about how diplomatically aggressive do you want to be. Secondly, there are also divergences over whether or not to use the military option, not by ASEAN itself, but by individual member countries, by their own national planning. Some view China as the bigger threat. Some view Vietnam as the bigger threat. So there are strategic divergences over that as well. And at this point in time, even though I say that there's a collaborative relationship between ASEAN and the UN, keep in mind that the UN, and you know this, the UN themselves have their own politics, especially with the Security Council and P5 nations, and with veto power and all that kind of stuff. You know, they have their own high-level elite politics over there. And that would also put a spanner in ASEAN's machinery and their workings. So it is a collaborative relationship, but both at the ASEAN and the UN level itself, there are internal politics that may dampen the efforts at this point in time. Now, one of the more prominent divergences and one of the more prominent examples of a division between within ASEAN, the organization itself, was revealed by this thing called the Kuantan Principle. Now, you don't really need to go into the details of this, but basically the Kuantan Principle was something that was formulated by Indonesia and Malaysia, but kind of like bilaterally, within themselves first, then later they presented it to ASEAN, and it caused a lot of furore and it caused a lot of controversy when the rest of the ASEAN members heard about it. Why is it called Kuantan? Because the two nations, their representatives, they met in this place called Kuantan, and they discussed this principle. Now, the controversy here is this. The controversy here is that by the Kuantan Principle, Indonesia and Malaysia believe that they should, in order for diplomacy to resume, and in order for diplomacy and negotiation with Vietnam to start, what they could do was just to, in a sense, recognize the occupation first. And this was premised on the belief that Vietnam would withdraw would be amicable to the withdrawing of its military forces if this was in a sense recognized, the invasion itself. And they believed that this was the first step, and then later on diplomacy can be resumed. So it's not so much a deviation from diplomacy, but it is their own brand of how they conceive as a way forward. Keep in mind that Indonesia especially has their own strategic calculations on China. And remember that China did invade Vietnam. So that fear of Chinese encroachment was heightened and is ever present in Indonesian calculations at that point in time. So it could have served as a motivation as to why Malaysia and Indonesia, they met together to try to devise this approach towards resolving the issue. Now, on the scheme of things, it can be seen as an accommodationist stance. And when they presented it to the other ASEAN members, they were quite adamantly against it. Thailand, Singapore as well, and so on. Why? Because I think the other ASEAN members saw that this was a betrayal, or at least it was it ran contrasting to the ASEAN way principles, especially with regards to respect of state sovereignty and international law. Because by recognizing the invasion, the occupation, and this kind of stuff, they felt at that point in time that it was legitimizing the Vietnamese action. So I think that was a huge controversy over there. And ASEAN kind of found itself not as united, or it presented to the world a division within ASEAN, and it was politically quite embarrassing to the whole thing. So I just wanted to point this out because we can see that at that point in time, it's not say ASEAN is fully coherent or fully united. There are smaller groupings within the five at that point in time. Interestingly enough, when the Quantum Principle was released, Vietnam, who's supposed to be the recipient, I guess they're supposed to be the most happy when they see something like this, but they themselves also rejected the Quantum Principle. And it's really, really interesting to me because I think I mentioned this in tutorial that it's one of those wars which is really fascinating because every single disputant that is involved in this conflict right now wants the conflict to continue. Vietnam wants the conflict to continue because they will continue to receive Soviet aid. Cambodia wants the conflict to continue, for obvious reasons. They want to, get out of the situation that they are in. China wants the conflict to continue because of their rivalry with the Soviets and increasing their influence in Southeast Asia. Soviets, the Russians, they want the conflict to continue because of the Chinese calculation as well as the US calculation. Then the US, they also want the conflict to continue because of their own zero-sum game against the Soviets. So everyone wants this conflict to continue. And sometimes when we try to account for why there seems to be an ineffectiveness on ASEAN's part, or when we try to account why the conflict continues to drag on, I think we have to ask ourselves, is it because of ASEAN's internal failures, its inherent failure at management, its ineffectiveness, its lack of clout and blah, 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 blah? Is it things to do with ASEAN, or is it things to do with the external environment, that it is just not time for it to be resolved? There isn't a quick solution to these kind of things. So this is what I mean by contextualization. Whenever we consider an issue and we want to make an assessment of things, make sure that we contextualize the issue in order to get a fair assessment about things. So these are some questions that you can think of at this point in time. Now, one of the big things that comes out of ASEAN is that ASEAN's success. Remember just now we said that ASEAN successfully lobbies for an international conference to be convened in order to highlight and raise awareness about this issue and to debate about it and so on. So this conference eventually became known as the International Conference on Kampuchea. 1981. From now on, I will use ICK, short form for this international conference on Kampuchea. So the ICK, again, is a result of successful ASEAN lobbying. So once again, seeing if we can find small successes on ASEAN's part in terms of their management. This was a compromise between, remember, that's not a Kuantan split and all that. They managed to compromise some stuff, and basically the child of the compromise is the ICK. So it addressed Vietnamese security concerns, but it also, it addressed Vietnamese security concerns because, remember, one of the motivating factors for the conflict was that Vietnam kept saying that Cambodia was continually testing its borders, there was a security threat, and so on and so forth. So one of the things being said at ICK is to disarm Cambodian factions by UN supervisory force. So it kind of removes Vietnam's justification for their invasion. And also, the other proposal, work towards a non-communist alternative to the Khmer Rouge that had popular support and not threaten Vietnamese security. So, and with an internationally supervised elections. So this is the proposals of the ICK. But even though it sounds all good and everything, I think there are some things for us to consider because the situation is a bit more complex than that. Now, this slide in itself is going to be a bit complex, so if you need a break, you take one break now and then you come back to this later on. Now, the Cambodian domestic scene looks something like this. With ASEAN, the ASEAN Way principle, in fact, number one in the ASEAN Way principles, to respect the principle of state sovereignty and non-interference as well. So, the problem, right, is that with regards to the legitimate government of Cambodia, technically it should be the Khmer Rouge regime and Pol Pot. Why are they the legitimate government? Because they were the ruling party of Cambodia before the Vietnamese invasion. When the Vietnamese invaded, they removed the Khmer Rouge and they installed the PRK. So that in itself is an illegitimate government, and they did remove the legitimate government of Cambodia. But here's the problem. The problem is that the Khmer Rouge regime, they have huge humanitarian and credibility issues. You know this by now. And also it doesn't help the fact that they are communists and so on and so forth. So there are huge problems over it. So in the ICK, ASEAN proposed this formula moving forward for the Cambodian government going forward in order to try to reconcile the dilemma that they found themselves in. And this formula is called the CGDK, the Coalition Government of Democratic Kampuchea. So again, I don't think you really need to go into much into the politics of this whole thing, but basically, what this government is like a nationalist government, if you want to call that, taking from different political factions in Cambodian politics, piecing them together and forming a coalition government. So you have Sihanouk from this party, you have the Khmer Rouge, and then you have the Khmer People's National Liberation Front. So in a sense, this formula kind of respected the idea of legitimate government, because number one, this was of the Cambodian people. Number two, the Khmer Rouge are part of this coalition as well. So it's not like saying, oh, you cannot be part of it and so on and so forth. So kind of like this formula is to get an all-party nationalist government for Cambodia going forward. Why is this so complicated and so on and so forth? It's because some have criticized this as ASEAN contravening its own principles, because this also kind of looks like interference in someone's domestic affairs. Again, whether you see it tantamount to interference, I leave it up to you, and you can kind of negotiate that. But there is that criticism out there. But at the same time, in this context of war and conflict and trying to find a way, a political way forward, maybe sometimes the exigencies of the matter, the necessity of the matter calls for something like this. So again, this is something for you to take note of and see that ASEAN was dealing with a really, really complicated issue that had no overnight kind of solutions. However, the ICK and so on and so forth, at that point in time, I think it was, in some quarters, it was considered a diplomatic defeat. It was opposed by China with US support. Remember I told you that in the UN itself, there are its own set of politics, Security Council, P5, and all that kind of stuff. You can see the amount of influence they have on proceedings like this. So it was opposed by China with US support. I think the reasons by now is obvious. So both of them had no interest in accommodating Vietnamese concerns. The US supported China's policy as part of its own zero-sum game against the Soviets. So ASEAN ran into all sorts of problems at that point in time. However, is there a silver lining to this whole thing? Yes, if you extend your assessment period. Meaning to say that at that point in time, the significance of the ICK may not have been seen at that point in time. However, did the ICK serve as some sort of foundation, some foundational document or some foundational approach which would then be adopted consistently across time, leading on all the way to the resolution itself? So that's what I'm basically proposing over here. The ASEAN formula for the settlement of the Cambodian crisis called for ceasefire and withdrawal, UN arranged and supervised free elections in Cambodia, peacekeepers to ensure security of these elections, and so on and so forth. So all these things at that point in time, I don't think it was the right time given the context. No one was really willing to listen. But the ideas proposed at the ICK that was convened by ASEAN in the first place, these ideas survived the test of time and it was continually referred to. ASEAN continually lobbied for these things across the years. Finally, when the time was right for everyone to listen, when everyone wanted to listen, then all these things gained a lot more traction and a lot more momentum. So after the ICK, ASEAN directed its international efforts towards gathering support and credibility for its formula, the CGDK. Diplomacy was very successful, as evidenced by the ever-increasing majorities in support of ASEAN's annual UN resolution calling. So you can see the relationship with the UN continues, their lobbying effort continues, their messages and their statements are consistent, and so on and so forth. So sometimes I get it. Like at that point in time, it may look like a complete failure. And at that point in time, it may look like ASEAN is ineffective, they are incapacitated, they are handicapped by larger powers, and so on. Okay, sure. But what if we take the assessment in its entirety? Sometimes to understand management, we need to understand the context, the contextual shifts, and what the organization was doing throughout the entire time to get a holistic assessment of the whole thing. At the end of the holistic assessment, if you say that, oh, ASEAN is still pretty shit and so on and so forth, okay, sure, but at least you did consider the entirety of it, which is what I would push you guys to do so. So same questions about ASEAN and its relationship with the external environment. Now, finally, we get into the last phase of the Cambodian management by ASEAN, towards peace, towards a resolution at the Paris Peace Accords of 1991. Now, as I mentioned, moving forward from the ICK, ASEAN continued its lobbying efforts. They either did it through regional means or they did it through the UN. Indonesia was, as you know, always looking for an opportunity to display leadership in these kind of situations. And I do mean in a genuine way, like in a genuine fashion. Indonesia was always at the forefront of trying to find a way forward with regards to this conflict. December 1985, it called for a cocktail meeting among all Khmer factions. So this was the idea here was to look at all the political factions of Cambodia and to call all of them to a meeting to see if there could be a way forward. The cocktail diplomacy here, very effective. is that kind of the brand of informal diplomacy that is non-threatening by nature. It is not going to be coercive. It's not going to be impositional. And again, I think this informal diplomacy has been criticized to no end. But at the same time, you can see that in such situations, actually, it can be a really aligned approach. It can be an applicable approach, especially with its non-threatening element. I think that getting people to the negotiating table when they don't want to be there, something that requires a unique formula. And I think cocktail diplomacy and ASEAN's informal diplomacy does play a huge part in this. And then after that, there were certain other structures that were built upon. So the Khmers would meet at stage one, followed by the CDDK and Vietnam at stage two. So it's incremental. Remember, ASEAN is this organization that is really consistent with their approaches. Perhaps they are constrained and so on and so forth, and they are forced to adopt these kind of approaches. But at the same time, I believe that they are consistent towards it. Look at this thing here, stage one, stage two kind of stuff. We are looking at their gradualist approach, like gradual, it's incremental by nature. So taking it step by step, seeing how things go. Yeah, okay, criticize, say it's slow and so on and so forth, but is it aligned to the context, and especially in such a sensitive manner? Is this something that is needed, and is it something that actually works? So in 1986, you can see ASEAN started to be a bit more explicit in their proposals and also to be a bit more assertive in their proposals and putting forth at this point in time an 8-point proposal to resolve the conflict. Many of these things were later adopted as well, but you can take your time to read all 8 of them. Now, in 1987, Indonesian foreign minister, he visited Hanoi. So we can see that sometimes, even though it is not within an ASEAN platform, ASEAN members are pretty active, bilaterally speaking, in arranging their own forms of diplomacy and going to places and trying to arrange deals and all that kind of stuff. And some have said that, okay, this is an example more of a unilateral action, or this is an example more of a bilateral action. Okay, fair enough. But is there something that we need to consider when we look at the issue holistically? Because Indonesia could have been doing this on their accord, on their own agency and leadership and so on and so forth. But if it does come back to an ASEAN platform, if it does contribute in some way towards a planned ASEAN meeting or platform or whatever, then again, can we say that this was all part of the process and that Indonesia was not really acting unilaterally, but on behalf as a representative of ASEAN and the organization itself? At this point in time, Vietnam agreed to a proposal for an informal meeting without preconditions, but at a later stage in the discussions, Indonesia, they presented this proposal at ASEAN. So you see the connection over here. So Indonesia presented this proposal at ASEAN, immediately faced resistance from Thailand and Singapore. Okay, not everything is like all well, even at this late stage and all that kind of stuff. Some members from ASEAN, they want to be more assertive. Indonesia is saying that since we have this, can we just go ahead with this first and so on and so forth. Then it comes to this really important meeting, the Jakarta informal meetings, the GYM talks. So there's a GYM 1 talks and then there's a GYM 2 talks. Now the GYM 1 talks, they brought together 4 Khmer factions at the first stage. The second stage saw the inclusion of Cambodia, Laos, Vietnamese parties hosted by Indonesia once again. The significance of this meeting is that Vietnam participated in it. Now, when the aggressor party goes to a peace negotiation or this kind of negotiations, it is a huge political statement, because on some level of sorts, the aggressor party is now willing to talk, which does imply something. And for this, it does imply that the occupation itself is no longer sustainable, and Vietnam themselves are also looking for a face-saving way to go out. So the gym talks, again, it doesn't lead to resolution itself, not directly, but it is a ground, it sets a groundwork for further negotiations to take place later on. So this part is more about the gym talks and its significance, and something for you all to really take note. One of the highlights of ASEAN's management in this conflict. Then there is a second gym talk, gym 2 talks, and it takes place in 1989. But the gym 2 talks weren't as successful as gym 1. In fact, gym 2, they faced a bit of resistance, especially when it came down to the technicalities of the way forward. And so the only kind of meaningful outcome that came out of gym 2 was that all parties agreed for an international conference on Cambodia, and this paved the way eventually for the Paris Peace Conference on Cambodia. So finally, long story short, 1991, there was the UN, and the UN was involved, and there was the Paris Peace meeting on Cambodia, and the issue was finally resolved at that point in time. So, here takes us to the end of this conflict, and the big question once again remains about ASEAN and its management of the conflict. Was it a triumph, or was it dependent upon external powers? Did it face internal issues, or were these things overcome eventually over time, and so on? I think that whenever we do our assessment of effectiveness of ASEAN and its management of regional security, the two things to really take note of is, number one, do take note of the context. Number two, do take note of ASEAN's mandate, their objectives, as well as looking at the entirety of the conflict, or as much as you can in your assessment of this conflict. So yeah, this would be the lecture series on ASEAN and the Cambodian conflict. There are still some questions which I would like to pose to you all in tutorial class, but I think I'll save it for that. And these are primarily questions on why... these are primarily questions on the external environment. Why was there increasing momentum later down this conflict for resolution? I think I haven't really covered that part yet, and I kind of want to discuss that with you guys in tutorials face-to-face as well. Okay, so thanks guys, hope you enjoyed this, and see you soon.